Okay, we're recording.
Okay, we'll call this working meeting for our commissioners. It's on Wednesday, March 29th. It's about 1:36. Okay, we'll close the meeting for a public hearing on budget amendments fiscal year 16 and 17. Any public comments? No public comments. Okay, we'll open the meeting back up.
Here's the amendments. You want me to read any of them, or do you just want to look at it?
Do we vote on them today? We have to vote those today.
You have to approve them to do them.
Okay, why don't you read it, and if there's anything you want to explain, unless there's a lot of reading.
Well.
Oh.
And this is just the backup notes that explains why the other net changes. I can go through it. Just kind of touch on some of the things. Most of the changes, there was no net effect. Majority of them were line items that people didn't budget anything to spend or weren't expecting revenue for, and we did get some. So I had to give it revenue receiving authority and budget spending authority. A lot of the funds, they just decreased one of the line items and increased the line item that didn't have spending authority. So there was no net change in their overall budgets. So their bottom line, what they said they're going to spend was the same. They just moved money around a little bit to give one spending authority and decrease another one. A lot of the general fund, the commissioners, there was unemployment that we had to compensate for, because as elected officials, you don't have unemployment. But with Janaea and some of the staff that you have helped over the fiscal year, they are subject to unemployment. So I had to give that spending authority. So I just decreased by $52 traveling expenses, or one of the line items that you haven't touched yet. So you haven't used it. Same thing with Justice Court. They didn't spend anything on office supplies, decreased travel. Accounting office, there's a new line item for utilities with changes we did with the internet.
Oh, okay.
And things that each fund, so finance and accounting had that change. And there was a couple line items. Corey didn't have any overtime budgeted for the attorney, so I had to give that spending authority, and I decreased his PERS, because it's not going to be as much as originally anticipated. And a couple of line items where he didn't have anything budgeted, professional services that he needed for one of his courts, and just decreased like operating supplies. DES, the project, what they call his project, basically in that module, didn't have any of his salary and wages budgeted, so I had to give that spending authority. I did in the regular part of it, but there's two parts when there's projects, and DES wanted his salary and wages, because it's grant-based, to have its own project number separate from the regular DES.
Oh, okay.
So that's why that got missed last year. And then the health fund, the public health, I went through and did all the amendments when we said we were going to hire Joni full-time. So I went back through based on the hours they've already worked and what they're going to work the rest of the fiscal year for the three of them, and essentially decreased the wages in general fund, and then it decreased bioterrorism, MCH increased. So it switched some of what we originally had budgeted down, because when we did budget, they weren't hired yet. So we went and changed that around to compensate for having Joni full-time. The net effect on that was only an increase to the overall part of their budget by like $3,000. So it was better than we thought it was going to be when we first were looking at it. So Teresa was really excited about that one. So those are on there. Same with mosquito. When we first did budgets, there was nobody governing it. Once Scott was appointed, Part of his proposals, we reworked his wages and got him and Chris all situated. And essentially, it's just taking from like a rebudgeted cash line in there, which he wasn't using anyway, and just gave that spending authority to Warren Mosquito. So that took care of that for hours.
I didn't know he increased his wages. I know you talked about it.
Well, what it did is he's charging less to weed and some to Mosquito to get Mosquito up and running. So he's still getting the same wages. It's just being split between the two different funds.
Oh, okay. Okay.
But when we did budget, the Mosquito Fund didn't have anything budgeted other than an hour that Tammy was kind of doing to help answer phones and keep track of mail and things as they came through for her time. And then when Scott took it over and accepted the responsibility, we went through and calculated the hours, how much time he thinks he and Chris are going to spend running Mosquito versus weed. And so we just split that up at a percentage, kind of like we do Brooke. Part of her time is with as attorney secretary and the other part's victim witness. So the same thing with Mosquito. So it charges each one separately, but they still have the same wages that they had at the beginning of the year. Which okay. splits it. Okay. Airport, there was a couple of a project that didn't get rent or something like that for the airport that we didn't get budgeted in the project for the little one.
Silos,
yes. So, gave that spending authority. We didn't get that in the projects. It's fluke. We got it in the regular one, but not in the projects. And it's kind of silly the way Black Mountain has to do it. I have to do it twice. In anything, there's a grant or a project, I have to do that too. And I missed some of them last year. Public safety. Once we merged the detention fund all into public safety, there was some transfers to take the cash and expenditures that were hit in detention to go into public safety. The auditor's recommendation to make them one fund again. So after I did that, I had to give spending authority to, like the BOR was one of them, increase spending authority for some of the other line items in there because they had different accounts in public safety than detention, so I had to add those accounts and give spending authority into public safety. Okay. There was a net expenditure increase of $10,922. Some line items were decreased, some were increased. The detention center, there was an overall decrease in the net revenues to transfer those revenues into public safety by $159,165.82 so that fund became zeroed out. And the auditors looked at it while they were here, so that was done and taken care of. But I had to give the authority in the record officially.
What was the amount?
$159,165.82. Okay. And the journal on that was 520. You guys should have had that in your boxes back when all that was done, when some of your monthly reviews. The community development revenues should have been going to planning. So I had to do a decrease in community development and put it into the planning because hers again was those three functions are now coming out of the planning fund rather than the two separate funds of $6,291.
So we just take this out of the planner's wages.
So it's, yeah, it, what it does is it so took it from the revenue.
Right here. I don't want to hear my time.
I'm sorry. Didn't mean to interrupt, but I had to get that in there.
So it just switched the revenues from the economic the community development to the planning to help cover her wages for her time and operations that she spends doing community development. So that was basically a wash between the two. It just had to get authority to increase and decrease the revenues accordingly. And there was, Scott had a wee grant, revenue and expenditures that came in mid-year that wasn't budgeted for, that I had to give spending authority of $4,000. And it was up to Project 553. And then metal mines and state allocated federal mineral royalties. We didn't have budgeted money to receive revenues, and we did. I had to give that spending authority to receive it.
What did we receive?
The state allocated mineral royalties. There was we received revenues of $725. And 2896, the metal mines revenue, fund 2896, we received, and I think it's because the mine up Weasel Creek opened up,
mm-hmm.
So there was some revenues there of $987.14. So I had to give those revenue receiving authority. Pilt. There was a couple of line items that, mainly the main one was for the sheriff vehicles that we was approved at the beginning of the year. It was kind of the last minute, so I didn't have expenditure authority given to it, but it was already spent, so I had to just give authority to spend that. Doesn't put anything in evidence, so I had to do that. Homeland Security, there was some monies received. There was money spent that wasn't expected to be spent. We got the revenues and it didn't get expenditures of $7,300. There was revenues, I had it backwards. There was revenues of $103,965 for some of the grants that Conkey Radios and Communications that he got and applied for after the year started. The Deep Creek project, that was another one I had to really look at, because this year, you know, the auditors want us to get it on track because phase two is going to be a huge undertaking cost-wise, and so we'll be subject to probably a federal grant on that one, audit, because of the federal grant. So there was some expenditure increased by 410 that wasn't budgeted. The line item was spent out of it was like publicity. And the revenues was a net increase of $10,181.36. And then the sheriff's vehicle CIP fund. That's where some of the car was paid for. So when PILT transferred as a expenditure out, they had to record it as a revenue in. And we paid for it out of their CIP of $42,072.70. And then there was a typo error in their fund. And instead of $25,000 being budgeted, it was $250,000 budgeted.
Oh.
There was an extra zero put in there, so I had to decrease that revenue by $207,000 so it wouldn't overinflate their CIP. That was a scary one. And then extension, they apparently rented out their no-till drill or something and had some unexpected revenue that she didn't have budgeted for of $2,050. And then the detention center CIP for the cadaver cooler. It was missed spending and revenue authority. It was kind of done at the last minute or mid-year, so I had to give that spending and revenue authority. $13,410 was the revenue. The expenditure was $15,184. And then solid waste had a line item that he didn't budget for of $110, so there was a $110 revenues to give spending authorities for. And then the others were the trust and agency accounts that didn't have things budgeted. It's the rural fire, TV district, hospital, and Three Forks Mosquito. Rural fire had revenues of $10,187. And TV district had an additional little expenditure of $346. The hospital operations revenue, $116. And Three Forks Mosquito expenditure by $50. That was publicity or something for the paper. Much better this year.
Yeah. Any other questions on this?
What was the rural fire one on the last one?
Rural fire revenue net increase of $10,187.47. And when I get the amendment in the system, all these amounts will be reflected in all the appropriate funds budgets. So we'll be able to see that if you had a report before and after, you'd see where there was zero, should have put these monies in there. So then everybody's got a more up-to-date budget. So that hopefully you can get us through the end of the year and we won't have another amendment. I'm hoping. But if we do, we do. But hopefully that'll take care of it. And so far people are good, looking good. Bottom line fund is what we do, and we are supposed to be spent about 72%, which pretty much everybody has stuck right to that. There's some line items that might be a little over, but as long as the end of the year comes and they don't bottom line go over, it's looking good, which is what they're supposed to. So people are doing good.
So what we need is a motion then to make these budget amendments. Correct?
Yes.
I'll make a motion to do the budget amendments as read.
I'll second it. Any more discussion on it? I will go for a vote. I'll call for a vote on the budget amendments as stated.
Aye.
Motion passed.
Yes, they do need to sign it. I forgot about that. Yes. Thank you.
Building project, Intercap loan drawdown request. Okay, what's the status on that now, on that Intercap loan?
I've got an invoice ready. I went through and pulled all the claims from WWC or any vendor that has anything to do that's been paid for towards the building project, Intercap building project, and have an invoice that we can submit to the Board of Investments, who's kind of sponsoring that original $400,000 that we were working on to put the building out.
That's the Intercap loan.
The Intercap loan. Mm-hmm. We have to send that into the Board of Investments. They reimburse us for all of these, and in turn, we make repayments over the course of the years that we agreed to pay, or as much as you guys want over the life of the loan. Payments are twice a year.
What if we just pay that off and do away with it?
Have you guys, it's all been paid. County's paid for it anyway, because we have to pay the vendors. So right. That's kind of up to you guys what you want done with it. I was just asked to throw it together, or it's been kind of my job every 6 months to kind of bill for things for that. So that's what I did, and that's what this is here for, whatever your decision.
That way, if we pay off or no more interest or anything like that on it, and that fund is done and over with, right?
As far as I know, whatever you guys are.
What's your feeling on that, Mike?
Yeah, I think we're just getting reimbursed for those claims, right?
But then, we were borrowing from the Board of Investments that money. And it was kind of like we had to pay for it, pay the vendors, and then we could request it. So we were like borrowing the money to pay for it. Okay. But if we're not moving forward with it, then you already paid the money to the vendors. And as long as you don't ask for it, you don't have to pay for it back.
Yeah, and then we made, there probably be another little bit of interest payment, because there was one I think we just made here.
Yeah, there was one made in February. The next one is due August 15th. But the interest went up from 1.5% to 2.5%. Okay. And so the payment would be.
So if we just, they just prorate that part out. So, and if we just, I don't know what the right word is used, do away, wipe out that.
Close the loan, pay it off, yeah.
Yeah, I think I'd make the motion to close that loan out.
Okay. I'll second it. Motion was made and seconded to close out this loan. Any other discussion? No for a vote in favor of the motion to close out this Intercap loan. I still call it Intercap, which
that's what it is. Yeah.
Anyway, yeah. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion passed. Schedule. I think we go ahead. You want to present the information on the budget 101 presentation?
Okay, sent you guys emails. It contained these two documents. One was Harold's PowerPoint slides, both big and easy to read. The other one was by his predecessor, Gordon Morris. And 05 was Gordon's version. His is a little more detailed in reading than the PowerPoint slides, but it contains the same information. It might just be outdated, some of it, with the codes. But it all contains the basic information on kind of how to budget and what we do and why we do, who has the authority. Did everybody have a chance to read it? Any questions? I think you need a response to that question.
Lots of questions.
I don't know kind of what to ask for. But basically, you know, what you guys are doing is submitting your budgets to the commissioners. I put it in the software and it kind of calculates all our spending. Get some numbers so you know what you have to work with. There's statutes that guide what we do and what I have to follow. I did print off and make copies because it talks, Harold's, we talk about the funds and accounts and working capital and different things. And so I took the BARS book where it summarizes what one fund 1,000 is the general fund, fund 2,000 are special revenue funds, and so on and so forth. So it gives you an idea of where you fall, why you have the fund number you do. And I did the same thing with the revenue accounts. So you know if you're getting revenues, kind of what category it falls into, whether it's cash or taxes, or if there's prepaid expenses or money from grants or other kinds of receivables. So you kind of know where it's gonna go, where to look at it, what Doug's office does when they receive it in. The liabilities as far as when you pay them, and loans, kind of the same thing, where it would fall when we set them up to paychecks, where in here it would fall from what liability, in short term, long term, and capital assets investments, like the intercap loan was going to be a long term investment. Revenue is the same thing. That one's more the big one that most of us see is the revenues, whether if it's taxes, grants, or other sources, how we fund those and code those. So when you're filling out your revenue budgets and you know what kind of money it is, it should fall in one of these categories. And then it goes into more detail based on each department. There's thousands of codes within that account it could go to. But I thought it would help people understand what they're looking at. I haven't done that before. When I'm making accounts, need a new account, that's what I go to. I go to this, it's kind of my manual. Revenue expenditures are the same thing. Why your account is where it is, whether you're in the general, public safety, culture and recreation, housing, community development, public health. Any of those kind of tells you where you fall within there, so I know how to send up new expenditure accounts, that you're in the right place, new grants. And then the objects, the final little piece, salary and wages, that's why they all fall, have a 100 number on the objects. Most of your expenses are gonna be a 200 or a 300, depending on if it's supplies or a purchase service. So it kind of helps you know when you're budgeting why it goes under one and not the other. And when we go to pay claims, this is what we look at. Make sure we hit the right line item, because it's important when we do our annual report, because it filters through all of these, so it shows the true expenses, revenues, all those good fun things for our annual report.
So you make copies.
So
for
I make
us.
Copies for everybody who wants one. Okay.
Now, like she said, she had questions. So the question will come when they come. On their budget.
Mm-hmm. Or if they have questions, you know, that I can go through and answer here today. I mean, I could sit here and read this to you, but I don't think you want to hear me read this to you.
No, I don't.
That was a little bit confusing to me. I know I've only been here for 6 months. I've done budgeting before, but never to this great a detail. So when I read that stuff, I was just like, ugh. It just was almost too much. But it did explain a few things. But most of the questions I have really are department specific.
And I can work with you one-on-one on those.
Right. So I've been working really hard on this, and I've just hit some roadblocks, okay. And I can't get past those until I have like a one-on-one with
okay.
you. But I do have a question that might concern everyone. When I figured out what the total cost for medical was, I was shocked because that turns out to be like over $1,000 per person. Is that correct? Or
for health insurance?
Yeah,
it's $1,090 the commissioners pay.
Per person.
Mm-hmm.
Wow.
Mm-hmm. The total premium went up another $50. Oh, God, top of my head was
$1,380.
Is it going up $1,380?
That's where it went to.
Yeah.
$1,330.
Yeah, it added $50 to what it was.
Okay.
The employers are going to pick up that $50 for now. Or we've proposed to pick it up. They haven't made their final decision yet.
Okay.
Because there's so finite money with the mill levy and the general health levies. There's only so much money to go around. And the commissioners are paying $1,090 of that, which
mm-hmm.
equates to a little over $6 an hour as a fringe benefit.
Okay.
That... we don't have to pay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
If we had to pay that, we would want to see $6 on our paycheck for an hour.
Right.
To cover it.
Yeah.
Which we don't because we have really good insurance. So, it's going to be nip and tuck. We might end up having to pick up more depending on how the valuations come about.
Mm-hmm. You know, it's good insurance, but have you ever checked into other?
Oh yeah, we can't, and they can't compete for the cost.
They can't.
The employees would pay three times out of their pockets what they have to pay now. It would save the commissioners, maybe,
mm-hmm.
and the levies, of which they might be able to do health savings, but we'd still see that hit our paychecks
mm-hmm.
hard.
Okay. I was just blown away.
Maker Healthcare Trust, I've challenged them to come up with the same plan and benefits
mm-hmm.
that we have now. They said they can't do it for the cost we pay. So there's no way. So,
and is it because of high risk, or?
No, we are part of a self-funded trust with several states, picking through the union that the sheriff's office has. It's only available to those that are a unit, a bargaining agreement. Okay. And because the sheriff's office has a bargaining agreement, we get to piggy off of that as a county, as non-bargaining employees, and get that same benefit. So it's a huge pool of a lot of people within the union
mm-hmm.
across three or four states. So they can afford to keep the cost low, be a self-funded, that most of the local ones can't across
mm-hmm.
the MACO Healthcare Trust.
Because
mm-hmm.
I checked into it, most of them are like 565, and they're good plans. But
happens is it's based on the employee only, and if the employee wants to cover dependents,
mm-hmm.
their cost out of their pocket goes up. Which this plan, part of the terms of the trust, they make you put all your dependents on regardless,
right?
Because it's the same price for you as an employee.
Mm-hmm.
Have one of you or 20 of you if you had that many family
right.
members.
Right.
So,
mm-hmm.
and the risk is spread out. So thankfully we only had a 5% increase. I was expecting more. Here in the scuttlebutt around the medical community, health insurance was going up 10, 15, 20%. I was expecting more. So I was kind of relieved when you only said 5%.
Mm-hmm.
We got our letter.
So the other thing I was really stuck on, because everything is broken out, you know, I'm sure for every department, you know, postage, printing, you know, utilities, contracts, and stuff like that. And in our department, training, travel, all that stuff is all broke out.
Mm-hmm.
So what constitutes operations then? Because I have everything accounted for and I can't come up with what operations are.
That's where this little cheat kind of comes in handy.
Okay.
It's kind of what we refer to. So when I'm budgeting, I look at this. And it's based on your object codes. And I kind of summarize it in my...
What page are you on?
Memo. It's that last page with the object codes.
Oh, okay.
And basically, objects in your 100 range, 100 to 199, is your salaries and wages.
Okay.
Operations are 200 to 500. Those are your main ones for operations.
Okay.
And then after that, we don't have too many of these, like fixed charges, rent for a building, debt service, which would have like the intercap loan was under the debt service if you were going to pay for something.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's where the commissioners had that set up. We had to set that up. Grants, contributions, indemnities. Those people who maybe they make grants, like when the commissioners pay for the tree board grants and some of those, they paid out of the 700. And then the 800, 900 are... We don't use 800 much. 900 is your capital for your expenses over 5,000. And so it kind of breaks it down that way. So operations, pretty much everything on your detailed, from 210, which is your office supplies, down to like training, 380.
Okay.
Those are operations.
Okay. I'll take a look at that then.
And that's where the budget expenditure reports that I got everybody has prior year actuals. So if you're not sure what you want to do, what you're going to have, simple math, you take an average of your actuals.
Mm-hmm.
Or if you know you're going to have more, you add more. Inflation, 1.5 to 3%.
Okay.
It kind of depends, but it's not a set in stone. And the easiest way to describe your budget is it's your best guess based on your past spending and future needs.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's not a rocket, I mean, it's not an exact science.
Which is kind of hard in my department since it was so messed up last year.
Not having anybody there for a year or so, it was hard.
Yeah.
So we're getting there, though.
And so some of the lines are, like, way down, and it's not even reasonable for now.
Yeah.
So when I look at them, I just, like, you know.
That's probably where your prior
exasperating.
In 13, 14, and 15 will probably be more
close
accurate than your 7.
That's what I've found, yeah. Okay.
And then part of the budgeting process, when we submit our preliminary, after everybody submits everything, this is a form in the state budget report that has to be submitted. And it takes everybody's mills, it summarizes everything way down, all your expenditures, revenues, and breaks it down. It takes your cash on hand, I add what you want to spend, what your anticipated revenue, tax revenue versus non-revenue, and if you have mills, it should calculate your mills, what you need. We kind of go back at it from here's your mills and work backwards. Either way, that's just how we've always done it.
And did you get that from Black Mountain or?
No. This is something I will make once everybody gets their budget submitted.
Oh, I see.
We'll get this. It's something I have to send with the state budget report.
Okay.
But it's real simple because then it takes everything in a nutshell for everybody. So what everybody's fund, what their cash, what their expenditures, what their revenue is. This is last year's.
Mm-hmm.
And it kind of puts it all down when I get it together. And this is kind of what Harold refers to in his, some of these pages, the tax levy requirement schedule. That's what this is.
Okay.
He's just got like a bunch of pages in here.
Right.
And it's kind of hard to see it. This puts it all in perspective. I can, if you need a copy to look at, I can get you last year's. Last minute they recertified everything, and that was just right post my accident, so I don't know who all got it.
Mm-hmm. I've never seen that before, but is that going to be accurate for my department?
For last year it was. This was the final one that was submitted to state for last year's.
Oh,
so this year I'll start all over with
budget,
this upcoming year. And all that will change based on our evaluations that we get from the Department of Revenue. Or by then, everybody will have all their budgets, expenditures, revenues set in stone. So with valuations, there won't be a lot of, it won't be too hard to finish.
Okay.
Something a lot of people forget, if you do have grants, in our special projects, that I need copies of the task orders, grant paperwork. I kind of have to keep track of that for the finance side of things when the auditors come.
Well, you have copies of all my grants,
I have copies of yours.
One that's new is there's going to be a new immunization one and a new maternal child health one. So I'll make sure you get copies of those.
But they're pretty much the same standard. You know, we've got Deep Creek this year. There's lots more going on with that. Nicole's working with some departments to get new ones to help fund things here and there. And so some people don't know that I need copies of that.
Mm-hmm.
So it's kind of a reminder that if you have those or it's new, I need copies.
Okay.
It helps with the budgeting and know what helps me stay on order when you're charging things that you're staying on what the task is order you can spend from. So that I'm not paying for something that I shouldn't be because it says it's a no-no.
Exactly.
So it's educational for me as well.
Mm-hmm.
Keep up on that.
So you're going to get to Debbie then one-on-one and go through the rest of the stuff that you need?
Yes, okay. I sure can.
Mm-hmm.
Corey, did you have something or kind of a little behind
you? Yeah, I have a couple updates I need to give you at some point. I don't want to intrude on your agenda.
No, we're going to... About another 15 minutes before we're ready for the next one, so.
Okay.
I don't know if anybody else is going to be here other than her.
I guess I'll just give you a couple updates. There was an issue that's been kind of kicking around for at least a year,
It's a thing called the database ledger load, which, as I understand it, I don't understand it that well. State Department of Administration has imposed some accounting requirements into how the counties provide their financial data to the state. There were some additional costs to go with that. There was also some, they would charge late fees to certain counties if they didn't have data sent to them by whatever deadline they set. We had some late fees from, I think, 2014 that were, we were kind of disputing, and we had kind of waited on those, and MAGO was talking to the Department of Administration about those. So I kind of renewed the conversation through Harold Blatty and with the Department of Administration in the last 2 weeks. And basically, they're suggesting, and Harold's suggesting, we pay the late fee, but they have waived some of the late fee. So I just got an update, and I thought I'd sent it to all of you last Friday, but I may not have done that. I can provide it to you. But the short version is, there's a late fee of about $470 that would be the original late fee in 2014, which they discounted. They took 2/3 of it away. And then I think there was a year or two where we were good, and then there was another late fee that was either last year or this year, I'm not sure. But the point is that I'll send it around to you, but Harold's suggesting that we go ahead and pay this. It doesn't look like the state's going to come off of their position that counties do need to pay late fees. But in the course of all this, the state did waive a couple hundred dollars worth of our late fee. So I'll send it to Debbie, and then if you want to just prepare a claim, I guess, for
yeah.
it. And the update. So that's kind of, we waited on it for a while, and it's not going to get any better with time. So.
Yeah, see, the problem was is when they first came out with this database ledger load, they had flaws in it.
Right.
And for 3 months, we spent time back and forth working on trying to get it worked out.
Right.
And I went to go pay the late fee, and they said, no, because it's not our fault, it's their fault, they should waive it. Here we are.
Yeah. So I'll send that to Debbie, and then if I haven't already, I'll send the actual discussion between Harold and the Department of Administration and me. I'll send that to all you commissioners. So you have that.
Okay.
On the Deep Creek project, I have asked that we retain an outside counsel to work on that. And I believe I don't know if you guys have all gotten that request. I sent it to you, I think, Monday. No, it may have been Monday. Have you guys seen that?
No, I've been in Great Falls.
Okay.
Up until just an hour or so ago. So.
Yeah, I saw it.
Okay. So
Sean told me about it.
I talked to Sean Higley. He and I were supposed to have a meeting tomorrow to kind of go over more of the project. And I said, well, I'll just find out with the commissioners. I'm not asking you to make a decision right now, but just letting you know that the reason I was gone, I was in Helena today for a few hours on a big project that I've got to really sink my teeth into, that probably in the next 2 or 3 weeks I'm going to bring to you guys. I'm just doing a lot of research on it right now. But there's a lot of things in the hopper right now where I'm not going to be able to put the time or the attention into this thing right away. And not only that, but it's a deal that's unique enough, both in the construction aspect and also in the agreements between the feds and us and private landowners, that I'd feel a lot more comfortable if we had someone else do it who's done it a lot. Now the firm that I reached out to in Helena, they've actually done a lot of these agreements and done a lot of these types of projects. And the lawyer, the head lawyer, his name is Bob Murdo. He's out of Helena, and he has a lawyer in his firm that does a lot of construction law and arrangements. So that would be my recommendation to commissioners. But so maybe we could even, if I'm on the agenda for Monday afternoon, I'm assuming I am, for as part of my weekly meeting with you, then is actually Deep Creek on the Monday morning agenda at all?
It's on the, yeah, the agenda. Your part's in the afternoon.
I can come in the morning.
He didn't get put on the schedule. It wasn't in the book.
Well, that's... Oh.
For the afternoon,
yeah.
But he could. He can be here same time with WCC, right? WWC.
Yeah. So the 10:30. I'll come at 10:30. But that would be my recommendation. Actually, my request really for that project, because otherwise, I'm both in terms of time and in terms of that issue. I'm worried we're gonna fall behind on it.
Is that the name of his firm, Bob Murdo?
That firm is Murdo, or it's Jackson Murdo and Grant. Jackson Murdo and Grant. Got it, Helena.
Jackson Murdo, what is the last name?
Grant.
Grant, okay. Okay. By then you would know more of what it cost to be and stuff like that, but we should get on this right away then, should we? If you can't do it, we should get a hold of this outfit.
I would say if you probably need to make a decision when you're noticed to make a decision, but the sooner the better. And then he can, Bob in particular is available now to work on it, and then he has a lawyer named Scott Speed that works with him that is available. In 2 weeks, he's in the middle of some hearings right now, but he'd be available as well shortly after that.
Okay, well, I guess...
So I'll plan on coming Monday morning to your guys' discussion with Sean.
Right.
Hinkley. And then if you want me to bring anything more from them, I can certainly do that. I can call Bob and ask him to send a letter or something. We could have him come down, but I just wanted to bill us to have him come down for a wasted trip.
Yeah, maybe just a phone call to him and just present that then.
Okay.
Does that sound okay with you?
Yeah. I'm meeting with Doc Campbell tomorrow on the modular building, so I'll let you know what comes of that. And then I gave you a memo on hospital district issues, so just wanted you to have that so you can kind of see what's happened up to this point since I've been here, and then that last issue on some guidance from you if you guys want to pursue that issue with the loan or not.
So, is that something that should be done? I mean, it just keeps dragging on and on. That last part you had on there, on that loan.
It's an old issue that... Well, I guess there's more research to be done. If you want me to pursue research on it, there's more research to be done on it. So the short version is, like I put in the memo, I don't see how there's legally that we could do what we did, which was the state bank loan to the hospital.
That's the part that was illegal.
Say again.
That part was illegal.
I just don't believe the county has legal authority to do it that way. Mm-hmm. As I understand, the last payment is coming this October, mm-hmm. and then unless something's happened and it's been derailed, then the loan would be paid off in October of 2017. So one could say no harm, no foul, except that I think there was two payments in that period that the county made on behalf of the hospital. So those two, and I don't know what that amount was.
Around $60,000 each one, I believe.
Say again?
Around $60,000, I believe, each one.
Those two would be the lingering issue. That makes sense.
Okay, so you want to have that on the next afternoon meeting when we meet?
The question is really, what do you guys have? Do you want me to pursue more research, or do you want to let it be done, or what are your thoughts?
Do we need any more research, do you think?
The only question would be confirming those payment amounts and dates. Any correspondence, I don't have any correspondence associated with them, but I'm sure there's some out there somewhere.
But that should be all right there.
I don't think we need to do any more research on what those existing payments have already been paid. They've paid the last two.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And they're going to pay this one coming up in October, then that loan will be done.
Right. That's as I understand.
But then we're going to decide what to do with those two payments that the county made, right?
So the question is, yeah, exactly. And so... It's a tricky deal because it'd be the commission reversing a decision the commission made 4 or 5 years ago, right? It would be, I don't know if any of the current, no, were you on the commission then or not?
No.
So it just,
it was in 12 was on. When that was.
So it's, now you're into tricky territory as far as how you can reverse and go back and get that money if you can. That makes sense? So.
Kind of.
Question, I guess the point is, the reason I brought it up is because it's been, even in the last few months, both in the paper, both people in my office, et cetera, saying kind of all, everything's illegal. So I wrote the memo to go through all those issues. And every one of those issues are ones that kind of came to me and I had to deal with them since I took office. And that was the last issue that was kind of left. There was no action taken or sought. Does that make sense?
So
that's it. And I see it more as a civil than a criminal issue, so it's really up to you to tell me if you guys want to do something or just let it get done, get it paid off, and get it done. You can do nothing, let it get paid off, or you could say we want to get that money back, and then you may not be able to get it back.
Yeah.
You're in a complicated world as far as wanting to try and get those two payments back.
Would we be hung out there if we don't try to get those two payments back?
Commissioners at the time said they relied on legal counsel advice, and so that would have been right after Carla took over, and so there was a handoff when the Attorney General's office was doing some stuff, and then Carla was doing stuff, and Mako was doing stuff. It's not clear on who would have been the responsible attorney advising them at that time, so.
Okay. Well, I guess we'll just hash it out on the next meeting, and if you have any other ideas on it, then also, I guess, present them then.
Okay.
I guess I'll give some time.
Do you need me to have Michelle make an amended budget to have him at 1:30 on Monday? Or no?
Amended agenda?
Add it to the agenda.
What's on Wednesday?
That's department heads, and Wynn's going to take up most of the afternoon with this budget.
No, I have a court hearing on Wednesday in Helena, so I'm waiting to be here.
Monday?
I can.
If we get it done today, we can have it posted for the 48 hours.
It's up to you guys. The issues that I have.
Well, the next.
The issues I have can wait another week.
Okay, to that next Monday then. What's that meeting date? That's the 9th.
10th.
And the last issue is I would like to have a quick closed door update with you sometime real soon. I don't know if today, at the end of the day, if we could do a quick update.
Okay.
What time do you think it'll be done?
Oh, I don't know. It should be done in an hour, should we?
Well, Tracy, I don't think it'll take that long, and then we're done. Because okay. Jessica's not going to be here, so
yeah.
She's sick, so it's...
Should we just get a hold of you?
Yeah, I got a meeting with the weed board upstairs in my office right now, and then I'll come right back down here.
Good.
Okay. Okay. All right.
I put two minutes on it.
Take it.
I put two discs on Wendy's chair.
Are they those four?
I have a little bit.
Oh, okay.
Okay.
Tracy, you
can
put them like this.
The floor.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Thank
you. Can you give me a copy for Laura? Tracy, do an extra copy?
Yes, ma'am. Leave one for Laura, if not, I'll make it.
Yes.
Okay. Yep, that was extra.
Oh, I'm good. I got clear view.
I see that.
My first one, yay.
Is it?
You're the first one that's coming.
I stayed up late. I stayed up late. I need a raise. So, Debbie, thank you for sending that form, and I don't know if it was typable in it, but for some reason, some boxes came up and allowed me to put some stuff on here.
Okay, I'm glad you could.
But I wasn't sure if that's how it to look.
It's nicer when it's tight, but not everybody does that, so it's okay.
Yeah, and last year I wrote it. It's for some reason it let me get on there and type that. So
maybe Black Mountain changed something, so that's good.
So our DUI task force, for those of you that don't know, functions off of reinstatement fees. And those reinstatement fee monies come from suspended driver's licenses for DUIs and things like that. We get half of their reinstatement fee, and right now reinstatement fees are set at $200, so we get $100 of every person who reinstates their license in Broadwater County that has been suspended. That's our revenue. That's our revenue stream. It doesn't amount to a lot of money, roughly $3,000-ish a year. But a couple of years ago, we got a large influx of money for counties that don't have an established DUI task force. Those monies over years were just being deposited into one account, and they had a deadline for establishing a DUI task force, and when they chose not to do that, the state took all of that money that had been accumulating for 10 years and split it up evenly amongst all of the established DUI task forces. So we got 12,000, I think it was, which was a good influx that was a good deposit for us, but it was only a one-time deposit. Now, since then, some more DUI task forces have been formed, and for those counties that don't have one formed, we're still expecting an annual deposit, but we won't know what that is until the last minute. Last year it was 200 and some. It wasn't much. So that's probably the only amount left to really question, other than what we'll end up with at the end of this year. But I sat last night and tried to come up with a pretty good idea of what it should look for going into fiscal year 18, and I think it looks fine. Win?
No, I think it looks good. There's an increase. You'll see on the travel side, and that's because we do the every 2 years we do the
Lifesavers
conference. So that's not something that's done every year. It's expensive, so it's done every 2 years. And that's highway traffic safety folks and DUI task force folks and everything else. So that's, if you wonder why there's such an influx on that one, that's the mainstay for that. It's just that.
Which one is that again now?
That's under travel.
Yeah, travel. So,
oh, okay.
So that's the largest traffic safety conference in the nation. And it's held every year, but because it's always on the East Coast for the most part, so it's expensive for us to go there. Try to get someone there every other year, and that's why the increase in travel. Everything else kind of went down. Our operating went up a little bit. We had a few more things come up. We had a request to help with the Brandon Bear presentation at the high school this year, to help fund him to come and talk to the kids about drinking and driving. So that was an unexpected addition. Other than that, most of the things, we've been really good stewards this year of our money, kind of anticipating next year being a year that we'd want to go to that training.
We even decreased total this year about $2,000 from last year.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so our revenue, we can never anticipate who's going to reinstate their license or how many DUIs. If it were a perfect world and we were doing a really great job in eliminating all DUIs, we'd work ourselves out of revenue, which would be fine with me. That's not going to happen, but the part that we can never judge or anticipate is when they'll actually reinstate their license, because some folks don't do it right away. Some folks take a long time to pay that if they choose to, or they just drive suspended or whatever. So those are always unknown amounts. But that second page that I gave you, it's all the same stuff. It's just broken down into some subcategories so that when we turn our annual plan and budget into Department of Transportation, and when we're looking at this throughout the year, we've got a little better idea of some of the subcategories that we'd use our monies for. So the amounts are all the same between the two. The only difference is that second sheet just has a few more subcategories for expenditures.
Did you get any questions, Debbie? Are you really look okay for right now?
Mm-hmm. She's always awesome.
Yeah,
right. Everybody. So, well, make my job so much easier.
Hang on to this now until the. Well, this would go on the preliminary budget. Like mm-hmm. This year.
This will be pretty much for preliminary until the evaluations come out.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. And the only thing I really anticipate changing is if MDT tells us the exact amount that we can expect from for that other deposit from House Bill 132. And then if our last quarterly reinstatement B deposit is different than what I anticipated, those would be the only changes. I don't anticipate the line items changing at all. And our plan, our annual plan is due to Department of Transportation May 30th. So we have a meeting today. We'll talk about that. We've always designed our plan to be pretty all-inclusive and just changing some data, some crash data and some DUI arrest stats and the dates, to be honest. But we don't change a lot because it's pretty encompassing for it. So we'll meet today for our monthly meeting and then talk about that, and then I'll get on your agenda for here in a couple of weeks so that we're ready to get your signatures and get it to DOT by the deadline on May 30th.
Okay. Well, if there's nothing else, question for Debbie, I guess. We're all set then, for right now.
You guys are probably budgeted out for today, huh?
Started.
Yeah.
Yeah, really, most of the questions I have are
maybe we should do this
are just need your personal attention, most of the questions that I have.
Okay, thank you.
I have this interview in the morning, but I'm here probably by 11.
Right.
I'm here the rest of the day and Friday.
Okay.
I have something to talk to you about too before you close.
Okay.
Maybe I can meet with you tomorrow.
Yeah, we need
what time do you go to lunch? Or you just eat there?
Eat as I go.
Mm-hmm.
Within 63 hours.
I have anything to
call
it
hazard care. Phase one, phase two.
I kind of have had to keep my schedule pretty
open for the most part. Outside of, you know, I got the amendment done.
Probably that number.
I got payroll finished.
This one here.
Yeah.
Because payday's Friday.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Right.
Sneak it in between.
Mm-hmm.
Sign and forward.
I don't think it will
WWC
actually take that
FEMA
much time because I have it all written down. Just the
Montana
kind of bumpers that I've run into. So,
paperwork.
And I think it'll
be
easy
to
for you to answer those questions. So I just haven't been able to move forward without answers to those questions. So, yeah. So.
Or is that your motion?
I don't think it'll take us very long.
Motion.
I'll just run over tomorrow afternoon. I'll just text you or something.
If not, we'll go ahead.
So I'm like right in the middle of my deliverables too, you know, and so I kind of have to keep moving on everything.
After you get through, she's still.
Okay, are we done here? Okay.
I will get back to work and try to work on my deliverables.
I'll take that up to Michelle right after we get done. Or I mean after about here.
Okay, now I'm done. Needs to be on the agenda or not, because I've never dealt with these before. I have a city county airport lease agreement for what's that?
You found something.
I did, and I made copies and put them in the file because all that were in there were completed before.
Uh-huh.
So this is a Townsend City County Airport lease agreement for Dave Baggins. He's building, he would like to build a hangar out of the city county airport, not a hangar home, just a hangar. This has already been signed by the airport board. by Dave Beggins himself, and then he said that he's going to be meeting with Mayor Evans tomorrow morning at 9 a.m. So the last piece of the puzzle is for you as the chairman to sign this. I don't know that it needs to be an agenda item or not. I'll let you take a look at it. It's just a lease agreement for him to
lease agreement,
just for him to put his hanger there. Yeah. Because obviously he can't own the land. He can't own the land, so this is just the agreement for him to place his hangar on city county property.
Well, I think that's just an ongoing issue, I would assume. So I think you can go ahead and sign it, and then it just goes to the city.
Because evidently he's just going to meet with Mike tomorrow.
He's going to meet with Mike tomorrow. It's not a city council meeting that he's meeting with Mike. He didn't take it to city council. He went to the airport board, which you give that board, not authority, but I guess authority to a certain extent, to oversee all of that. You have the final say in everything, but... So that's why I didn't think it needed to be an agenda item. He stopped by today, and I said I would ask you.
Part of...
Ongoing.
Okay.
So we'll need a motion.
I'll make a motion on that the commission sign the lease with Dave Beggins pursuant to the airport board's approval of that lease. Or as the airport board has approved the lease, I guess.
I'll second that. If it moved and seconded, is there any other discussion needed on this? Then I will call for a vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Motion passed.
Perfect. And then it just calls for just your signature.
Okay.
On there.
Okay. So I'm in the right spot here. We'll make sure. County mayor. Okay.
Did you bring those claims down to sign? We want to sign those claims that are up in the mailbox, or did you bring those down?
Well, she's going to make the claim out now. What claim?
No, there's two sheets of claims up there that need to be signed.
They were
in the mailbox. They've been in there for a week. They were the ones that were carrying all the magazines. I took all the magazines out of there.
That's what's on my desk there.
And there's one in there from the Army Corps of Engineers is for you. Says Gail Dennis.
I'm signing on my desk. Okay, then we got to get that on. Are you going to mention that to Michelle? Have Corey on that 1 p.m. No, I can do that because that's not till the...
That's not till the next agenda.
Yeah.
Not
till the 10th.
So we don't have to do anything. But I did make a note to try to help her remember.
And we have that every, I don't know how we missed it this time, but usually every
Michelle was gone, she was sick, and I was filling in, and it wasn't in the book.
Yeah.
And with nobody being here Monday to put it in or check it, I don't know what some of the standing stuff should be in there is.
Lately we've been having him just about every week at 1 o'clock. And so I think that's all we have to do, just have that. I think how we got worded, yours are just ongoing issues, county issues.
And that was everything you fill in. You don't always know the latest and greatest.
You're right. Here's what we had before. Of course, ongoing county issues, decision and update.
I think Anne's supposed to be back tomorrow, so I'll make sure she gets this to record. She'll have to put a book and filing number on it.
This goes to back to you, because he's going to take this. I'll give this back to Nicole, because he's going to take this to Mike tomorrow.
He's going to take it to the city.
And this is a reminder.
What's that?
Is this
it? The list of claims?
Yeah. And that's how they got missed last week. You said they were mixed up with the magazines. Okay. Is that payroll or is that the claims also?
This is a summary for claims.
Okay, and I said this in here is 217. Okay.
And this is a summary of claims?
Yeah.
Is that what it's referred to as? Okay.
Or approved claims, I guess, is we always have.
$91,263.28.
I'll second that motion for the amount of claims at $91,263.28. Any other discussion? No discussion. We'll call for a vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion passed. Did you get the
number? I did. Yep. Okay. Thank you.
Let's see. I got to sign this. I'm relatively going to sign this one, really.
Yep. On the very back. Okay.
I'll make a motion to pay the claims in the amount of $37,339.74.
I'll second that motion. Motion been made and seconded to pay the claims in the amount of $37,339.74. Any more discussion on this?
No.
No discussion. We'll call for a vote. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Motion passed.
Dave actually is going to be back this afternoon to get it from me, and then he'll take it to Mike.
Okay.
And then when it's all done, you get a copy of it. Well, I think you actually get the original is what it looked like when I was rifling through the airport file.
The airport file leases.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
So we'll get a copy at the end once everyone's signed it.
Okay. That trip up record, is that still scheduled for tomorrow?
Tomorrow at 2 o'clock.
2 o'clock, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I posted it and sent notice to the paper.
Okay.
For both the commission and the planning board. I just put it all on one notice.
Yeah.
So the commission is up there too, and then we're coming back here for planning board meeting?
You are not coming back here for planning board meeting because it's planning board decision, and commission cannot be a part of decision.
Okay.
And as far as tomorrow's meeting, no discussion can take place between the commission and the planning board, as in the commission can't say, you know, I think that you should write this condition. You can't do that. You can make a mental list so when it hits your table, you can add conditions.
Okay.
But you can't make suggestions to the planning board on what they should do.
Can we ask questions?
You absolutely can ask questions.
Can?
Yep. You can.
Oh, you can? Okay.
Yep. You can ask questions of the planning board. It's all out there.
Right.
You won't be coming back
here.
In fact, you can't come to the planning board meeting.
Okay. Good.
It's open to everyone of the public except for the commission.
That's a wonderful
Yeah.
It's nice to be uninvited to a meeting, right?
Okay, now, weather-wise, occasion, the It sounds like it might be some rain or snow.
Yeah, 60%. So I guess bring your muck boots.
Put some clothes on.
Yep, muck boots. Okay, so raincoats. Yep, I mean, unless it's dangerous. But, I think we can all manage.
We'll just, turn off the highway there. Do we go in there a ways or we start from?
1.8 miles. So
from the highway?
Mm-hmm, from the highway.
It's up at the Y in the road.
Yeah, so it's almost up to the creek then.
What's at the Y in the road?
So where the road? Creek
before it goes to the left or to the right, it's right there.
Oh, okay.
It's not near the creek.
I mean, that's where we turn off, but you said it's another mile and an eighth.
You turn off the Ray Creek Road and go up a mile and eighth, and the Y, and that's where Rick Meyer lives, is right there. That subdivision's right there on your left when you come up to that intersection.
Oh, this is on that side. I was thinking it was on the other side.
Okay, but no, it's on the north side of Ray Creek.
Did Weider Road. Wasn't this the Weider Home subdivision? Did he have a subdivision start on that side too?
Just that side. Just the north side.
North side.
And exactly this piece is what he had proposed. So, I can show you on a map, but we're going to turn off before. Do you know where Dave and Sally live, by chance?
No.
Okay. Before you make the turn, so right as the road is forking, there's going to be a gate there, and then Dave is going to put signs up, so you'll see.
Yeah.
I'll be there early.
An approach right there, and an old wagon or something sitting right there?
That's what used to be there.
Oh, that isn't anymore there.
No, the wagon's gone, but the approach is still there.
Oh, okay.
It's right above Jeff Marks's. Eastbound.
Right, is that the one we turn on then?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, okay. Yep. Okay.
Yeah, I don't know if it's the east boundary road or it's literally right there. Wherever the gate's open. I mean,
it's
if that
just, gate, it just past just, Jeff Marks' mm-hmm. east boundary.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yep.
Didn't they put a well in there too?
They got power boxes and all kinds of stuff in there.
Oh, is there?
Yeah, there are. I think there's.
I thought I saw a well, but I'm not.
Wells, I could be wrong, but I think they put some test wells in there.
Yeah, there's a test well. Right.
And then I remember that wagon or something sitting there
mm-hmm.
a few years ago anyway.
Yeah. So it'll be interesting.
So are we adjourned then?
We'll wait for Corey to come.
It's a closed door. So.
Yeah. So.
Do I sit in and take minutes on a closed door? No.
We already made that mistake.
Okay, I'm not sad about that either.
It's up to one of us, I guess, to take notes on that thing. We'll see what it is, what Corey has. So.
Okay.
It used to be there never ever was any notes or minutes taken on a closed door meeting. Oh, you may announce it so it's on.
Yeah.
Okay, this meeting will be adjourned at 2:55. Close enough, I guess. Oh.
Perfect. Do I need to save these to be signed by Laura? Or do I just take them upstairs to Michelle?